In the early months of 2011, a mysterious Russian serial killer would emerge from Kazan, the capital of Tatarstan. Here, he would kill almost a dozen women over the next year, before moving on to other cities in the region. Kazan is the capital of Tatarstan, a republic within the Russian Federation. With a population that exceeds 1 million, Kazan, which lies along the Volga River, Europe's longest body of water, is located about 800 kilometers east of Moscow, and is the largest city in Tatarstan. You may know of Kazan because it was the host of the 2018 FIFA World Cup, and has become one of Russia's largest and most diverse cities. In addition to being a major hub for Russian travel and education, Kazan is also home to many diverse ethnic groups, including the Volga Tatars, a Turkic ethnic group that is native to the area, many of whom are followers of Sunni Islam. Kazan has grown to become the sixth largest city in all of Russia, and has become one of the nation's most reliable economic hubs. But it was here that a mysterious serial killer would make his first appearance at the home of an elderly woman who let her guard down just long enough to become a victim. On March 5th, 2011, an 82-year-old that lived by herself in Kazan, who was usually pretty cautious about who she opened the door to, even among her own family, was targeted by this unknown killer. This woman's phone had been out of order in the days leading up to her murder, and she was waiting for a repairman to come by and fix it. This possibly provided the killer with an avenue to gain entry into her apartment, but we will never know. Throughout the day, the 82-year-old woman's family would attempt to call her several times, but were unable to get through. Her adult daughter decided to stop by that evening after work to check in on her elderly mother, and would be the one to discover the woman's body inside of her apartment, having been strangled and left for dead. Investigators would later theorize that the crime had taken place that afternoon, sometime between 2:30 p.m. and the early evening, when the woman's daughter had arrived. Curiously, nothing of value had been stolen from the apartment, but investigators were not ready to rule out some kind of motive tied to material gain. You see, they would learn that the victim had often loaned out money to a handful of friends and family members, some of whom owed her upwards of 180,000 rubles, the equivalent of $6,000 at the time. However, that didn't explain how someone could or would commit such a heinous crime against an elderly widow that lived alone. The only thing that investigators would state was missing from the crime scene was a key to the apartment, which the victim often left on a table near the front door. Police speculated that this had been taken by the killer, who, after leaving the crime scene, locked the door behind him and possibly kept the key or disposed of it elsewhere. Over the past decade, that killer had gone to kill anywhere between 23 and 32 people, all of whom fit in the same demographic as this victim. Elderly women who lived alone, oftentimes in low-rent apartments built decades ago. Although, as you'll learn, this individual has potentially evolved to target older couples in general, and has become known for the region he primarily stalks his prey. This is the story of the Volga Maniac. In March of 2012, police responded to a crime scene along Grabkina Street in the city of Kazan. There, they would find the eighth victim of this mysterious killer, who had been instilling terror in elderly women and their families for almost an entire year. Originally, police had hesitated to label these crimes as part of a larger spree. For the first 6 or so months, that elderly women were being strangled or smothered to death throughout Kazan. Police investigated each of the crimes individually, believing them to be personal in nature, or tied to some kind of impulsive monetary gain. But over time, the killer's MO had revealed itself to be pretty uniform, and by March of 2012, nearly a year after the spree had started, Russian investigators were sure that this was the work of a single serial killer. This victim was an 83-year-old that lived alone in her apartment and had been strangled by an iron cord that the killer found inside. That had become known as one of the killer's calling cards.
He often strangled these women with items found inside their home. This victim had not been answering her family's phone calls for several days, and they eventually grew suspicious enough to travel to her apartment, where they discovered her body. Police were unable to learn why this victim had been targeted, but they suspected that it had something to do with the woman's pension, as she had previously worked on the home front for the Soviet Union during World War II, and her husband had been a soldier in the same war. Both of those gave her an increased monthly pension, and the killer made off with her life savings after strangling the life from her. This was actually the second victim of this killer that month. Earlier that March, an 84-year-old living in Kazan Starskaya Street had been strangled with a belt from her own nightgown. In that case, the victim's family had only been able to gain access to the apartment with a spare set of keys that her neighbor had, and they would find, like in all other cases, the killer had absconded with the victim's apartment key, locking the door behind him as he left the crime scene. As I'd mentioned just a moment ago, police had hesitated to publicly call these crimes related early on. They could find nothing linking the victims together other than their age and approximate location in the city of Kazan, and all seemed to have become victims of opportunity. But police would soon learn that a strange appearance had preceded the murders. A young man who introduced himself to those in the apartment buildings that these women lived as either a member of the building's staff or as a utility or social worker. Using these identities, the young man often asked about those who lived inside, and it was believed that this young man had been the killer, doing his necessary reconnaissance, hoping to learn where the vulnerable older women lived, so that he could later single them out. None of the apartment buildings or governmental agencies could recall hiring such a man, nor sending him out to those buildings in question. By the time police caught on to the trail of this killer, he had already managed to take approximately 8 lives within a single year, but was nowhere near finished. Police had begun to refer to this individual as Raskolnikov in the press, referencing the main character from the classic Russian novel Crime and Punishment, whose descent into mental illness causes him to lash out with violence as he breaks into an older woman's apartment to kill her and steal valuables. Over the next several months, this sadistic killer would continue to prey upon elderly women between 75 and 90 years old, those who were often identified as pensioners in news reports. Most of these women lived in the Ural region of Russia, relatively close to the Volga River, whom this killer would later be named after. It is believed that the killer posed as a social worker or an employee of the apartment building these women lived at, and through these identities, he befriended the women and eventually gained access to their homes. This individual typically struck older widows living alone in mid-sized apartment buildings that had been built back in the 1960s. These are known as kryoshchovka, cheap and affordable apartments, which those surviving off of pensions typically live in throughout Russia. Once he gained access to these women's apartments, he would smother or strangle them with an item he found inside. Pieces of clothing, small items, a pillow, etc. He would then steal whatever money or jewelry was readily available. But police did not believe that this theft was the killer's true motives. This was just likely a bonus for the killer, or a means for him to obfuscate this investigation. The first 9 murders took place in the city of Kazan, but a woman managed to survive what would have been the potential 10th attack in August of 2011. In that case, the survivor was hit over the head repeatedly from behind, but was unfortunately able to provide police with a very detailed description of the killer due to her poor eyesight. However, she was able to provide investigators with a broad description of the man who had attacked her, which matched what witnesses and neighbors had seen. A young man who has been posing as a social worker in the days leading up to this attack. In another case from September of 2011, the killer was interrupted by the victim's family member knocking on the door, who heard rustling sounds coming from inside the apartment but no response from their loved one, leading them to grow increasingly concerned. They were eventually able to gain entry to the third-story apartment, causing the killer to jump from the balcony to escape. This would be the last known murder in Kazan for several months, and from this point forward, the killer would refuse to strike at victims who lived above the second floor, as this incident almost resulted in his identification or capture. After these two incidents in the late summer months of 2011, the killer would reportedly begin to spread out into other areas of Russia, as his description began to be distributed amongst local authorities and news outlets. According to investigators who compiled this description from dozens of witnesses that had claimed to see the young man masquerading as a social/utility worker, the suspect was believed to be anywhere between 20 and 35 years old, stood around 170 to 175 centimeters tall, about 5'6" or 5'7", had a medium build, dark hair, dark eyes, and had a non-Slavic appearance, which didn't mean that he didn't look Russian, necessarily. He just might be of Tatar descent, and belong to one of the many ethnic groups native to the region. As news of this killer began to spread, police in Russia would offer up a reward of 1 million rubles, the equivalent of roughly $35,000 back in 2012, for any information leading to his apprehension.